Today we welcome Mr. Om Prakash Rawat to our show Amazing Mentor. Mr. Om Prakash Rawat is a retired 1977 batch IAS officer of Madhya Pradesh Cadre who served as 22nd Chief Election Commissioner of India. He has also served as one of the two Election Commissioner of India and Public Enterprise Secretary of India. Welcome, sir, to our show Amazing Mentor. It's a pleasure to have you on our show, sir.
Thank you.
So tell us, sir, about your childhood memories and when did you thought to become a civil officer?
Actually, when I was a student, my sole ambition was to become a teacher because my father was a teacher in a primary school. Therefore, my sole ambition was to become a teacher, and therefore, I did my master's in physics from Banaras Hindu University and also enrolled myself for PhD, that is doctorate in physics. But during my doctorate, I appeared for two interviews to join as lecturer in a college and in university. And I found that selection procedures there were rather skewed. In private college, it was the management committee which had the upper hand, so merit had no chance. And in university, the nepotism was so much there that anyone related to the big wigs will get selected. And there also merit had no chance. So I was in fact compelled to leave my sole ambition of becoming a teacher and go in for these competitions for Indian Forest Service, Bank Probationary Officer, Civil Service, like that.
So, bachpan ka safar sir aapka kaisa raha? Kaun se college mein aapne padhai kari? Kaun se school, kahan pe schooling kari sir aapne?
I studied in a primary school of the municipal committee where infrastructure was not there. In fact, I had to carry my own mat to sit there on the floor. After passing my 8th from that school, I went to Government Inter College. That had infrastructure, good tables and chairs and all those things. And after finishing my intermediate, I did my graduation from Kanpur University and Master's in Physics from Banaras Hindu University. I also did my Master's in Economics from University of Wales, UK.
When you were preparing, sir, what challenges did you face?
Preparing for civil service or any other competition is rather demanding. So, first thing is to look after your body and mind, because a sound mind can live in a sound body. And when you are competing, it's not a simple exam. You have to run a race and you have to come top. Only then you get selected. So, first thing was to cater to your mind and your body. And for that, I started going for morning walks, doing my yoga, etc. And also for running. I started looking after my nutrition intake so that my body is taking it easy. With that, I started. And for studying, actually that time, exam was very different. There were no prelims. There was not one optional, there were five optional subjects. You have to take three optionals for central services and two optionals for IAS and foreign service. So with that scheme, study was very important and you had to study five subjects. Since I did my master's in physics, so obviously I had physics, mathematics, and for higher level, I opted for history and philosophy. Those were the subjects that I took, and for general knowledge, I used to read newspaper, Hindu, Times of India, Indian Express, like that, and some general knowledge books which were available in the library of the university. So that was, I think, about all. And then I had a group in the hostel. All those people who were preparing for competitions, we used to meet over a cup of tea for about an hour and used to discuss so that we can explore our weaknesses and strengths. And that really helped, because when you are meeting your peers who are also in competition, then you learn what exactly is lagging in your preparation and what is needed to be done there. That helps a great deal, and that is what I think these coaching institutions in Delhi and elsewhere, they afford that opportunity to all the competitors to meet at a platform. Instead of just inputs from that coaching center, the most important benefit there is meeting your peers, seeing the competition, whom are you competing with, all those things are available there.
So when you thought to become an IAS, so what was that one change which you would have loved to bring to society once you have joined as an officer?
Actually, when you join, you have lot of ambition for doing excellent work, changing the ethos, changing the condition of the poor and downtrodden, changing the position of infrastructure in our cities and rural areas. All those things were in my mind. But when you go through the nitty-gritty, you realize that the system doesn't permit that kind of fast change. You have to convince the political leadership, you have to convince other stakeholders, then you have to mobilize resources, and then the agency which can match your expectation to execute those things. With that, you get sort of a little slowdown. And once that slowdown sets in, then whatever ambition of fast changes you were thinking, that gets diluted. However, if you persevere and if you continue, then you can deliver things to your satisfaction. That is what I learned.
When you told your parents that, okay, I have been selected as an officer, how was the reaction of your parents?
My parents were satisfied that since I was studying, and if I get selected, first I got selected in Indian Forest Service. They were very happy that our son has gone there. And there I was also satisfied, and I thought I'll remain here only. I won't appear for any other service. But there what happened, I got allotted to Himachal Pradesh. And Himachal is a state where some or the other plant is always flowering. So the problem was of pollens, and I had allergy to pollens. So I thought that there will be a consideration for change of cadre, but that didn't materialize. So I appeared for IAS just because of that compulsion. So second compulsion that I have to go out of Himachal, and therefore I appeared again, and that way I went into IAS. They were happy, very happy.
So how was your early days as an officer?
Early days in IAS are quite turbulent because you keep changing your places very fast. First you go as assistant collector under training, that lasts only about 10 to 11 months. Then you go as a sub-divisional magistrate, that also lasts about a year or so. Then you become additional district magistrate or chief executive officer of Jilla Panchayat or Jilla Parishad. That lasts for about two to three years, and then you go to a district. So initial years you have a lot of changes, places as well as positions, but that is to make you learn the nitty-gritty of public administration in your state, in your district, in your area. If you take it in that spirit, then you love it. But even if the changes are frequent, you are being exposed to different kind of experiences which will prepare you to handle more important responsibilities when you move higher up. That is what happens in the initial stages.
So what was your feeling when the power came to your hand? How was your feeling?
Actually, I never felt any change because I never realized that this is power. I thought that this was a responsibility to help the poor, to develop the area under my charge, and to make a place for myself in a manner that people respect you.
So as you told that there is too much of political pressure, so what all challenges do you face in day-to-day life as an officer?
There is a disconnect between administrator or civil servants and politicians in our country. But slowly it is reducing because now the exposure of administrator to the politicians and vice versa is taking place at an early age when they join as chief executive officer of Jilla Panchayat or Jilla Parishad. They have an interface with the political class. In my days, it was not there. As collector, you face political interface, and then as secretary. So very high up the ladder, you face that. Therefore, because of that disconnect, people had different notions. Some officers will feel people's representative is asking for something. That why is he asking this? Why should I do this? Whereas I felt that since this person is representing the constituency from where he is elected, constituents have aspirations. They want something from him or her. And therefore, this person has the duty to sort of help them get there. And looking at those things from that perspective, I found solutions wherever it was legal, it was proper, it was within the fitness of within the framework of law and ensure that it is delivered so that that person is also happy and his or her constituency are catered to. Wherever I felt that this was something which is blatantly illegal, unethical, wrong, I would first try to explain to that person that it is wrong. Please don't ask for it. And in case he insisted or she insisted, then I would put it in writing that this is all illegal and this should never be done. And whatever orders you pass, I'll take care of that.
So apart from political pressure, what all challenges the officer have to face in his day-to-day course of activity?
Actually, IAS offers you multifarious responsibilities. Like district collector, you are in charge for everything under the sun. Law and order, revenue administration, land administration, VIP protocol, security, all things under the sun are the responsibilities of the district magistrate. And so many challenges come here to your doorstep every now and then. In fact, there have been many instances where I faced a lot of challenges. And if you cater to teamwork in your district, if you have vibrant relationship with your team members like superintendent of police, divisional forest officer, engineers of public works department or irrigation, if you cater to the needs of your teammates and keep the morale high of your team members, then they all rally around you and you can deliver whatever you are trying to achieve. And I think that really brought success to me.
So what all departments have you handled in the course of your career?
In fact, after finishing my districts, I did Narsingpur and Indore of Madhya Pradesh as district collector. After that, I came to Bhopal, where I started with urban administration, you know, municipal corporations, municipalities, and urban poor, their welfare, their empowerment, those things. And then I got to information and public relations. That is sort of disseminating information about government and schemes, government programs to the general public, as well as creating an image for the government. Then I did some secretariat job where I handled again urban welfare department, urban development department, women and child development department, and then I went to Government of India, the Ministry of Defense, where I worked for procuring weapons and equipment for the armed forces, and then HAL, that is Hindustan Aeronautics Limited, Bharat Electronics Limited, and Ordnance Factory Board, manufacturing weapons, ammunition, and other items for the army. From there, when I came back, I was first given the charge of cooperative department, then agriculture department, then women and child development department, and then there was a change of government, so chief minister wanted me to become his principal secretary. So I joined as principal secretary to the chief minister, did excise for a while, then SC welfare, scheduled caste and scheduled tribe welfare, then vice chairman of Narmada Valley Development Authority. Narmada is a lifeline for Madhya Pradesh and Gujarat, and this is a huge project for Madhya Pradesh because 29 dams needed to be constructed on Narmada River, and total irrigation potential to the tune of 2.7 million hectares. So there I was for about 3 years. Then I again went to Government of India, joined as secretary to Government of India, Ministry of Heavy Industry and Public Enterprises, as Secretary, Department of Public Enterprises, and retired from there in December 13.
So any particular movement, any particular decision which you would like to share, which really touched your heart?
One very important decision, one important area when I was Principal Secretary, SCST Welfare, government brought in a very progressive legislation. It is called Tribal Rights Act. This was in 2007. They said that forest-dwelling tribals were met with injustices during colonial time when British government wanted to consolidate the forests of the colony, that is India. Though they made very good laws that whenever there will be consolidation of forests, district collector will issue a notification that government intends to take care of these forests as a protected forest or reserve forest, if anybody is cultivating on these land, can file objection within say 60 days or 90 days. And after hearing those objections and seeing the evidence, if it is found that his or her claim is right, then that land will be left out from consolidation and will remain with him for cultivation. But you know what happens when it was British period, everything was being done either in English or Urdu in Madhya Pradesh. The notice was duly issued, but you cannot even imagine that a notification on the office notice board of district collector in English, a poor tribal cultivating forest land 100 kilometers away from the district headquarters, how would he come to know that there is a notification that my land is going? So I have to file objection. He can't file objection. He doesn't know. And he is living hand to mouth. So he has to remain working every day. If he travels 100 kilometers, he will spend money. Then it is not certain that it will get done in one day. Then he will have all kinds of problems. So even law provided these things, but consolidation took place and no objections could be filed, no objections could be adjudicated, and tribals lost their land. And therefore, there was Bhil Rebellion in 1860s. This law, which was enacted in 2007, wanted to undo this historical injustice. But again, the same thing was there. Legal provisions were same, except for one change, that first level of adjudication will be Gram Sabha, village assembly, where all the members of the village, 18 years and above, will be the adjudicating authority. That was a very welcome change, but still, a lot of things were missing. So when I found that these things are missing, I got the law translated in tribal dialect of Madhya Pradesh, so that tribals can understand the law. Then I issued circulars that it will not be the duty of the tribal to attach a caste certificate, to attach the evidence. All this he will just mention from his or her memory, that I am gone, a tribe, and I have been cultivating this much land in forest, for which there was a preliminary offense report given to me 6 or 7 years back. That's all. Nothing else to be attached by him. And that really helped the tribals, though there was opposition from officers, that duty is being cast on them, for which they are not responsible as per the law. But then they cooperated. And last was Gram Sabha meeting. So generally, Gram Sabha meeting used to take place with just 10-20 people, and they would hijack all the decision making. Whereas this law provided that the minimum quorum will be 2/3 of the voters of the Gram Sabha. So to ensure that was very difficult, because these poor tribals were always gone for work, especially women. And women, when they come back from work, they will have to again cook for the evening meal of the whole household, also sort out the quarrels of their children, their parents-in-law, all those things. So they could never participate in any decision-making exercise. So I decided that if I really want to implement this law in letter and in spirit, I must ensure that the women also participate. For that, I asked the government that whenever a Gram Sabha meeting is held for this kind of decision making, we should invite whole village to the Gram Sabha place for dinner, so that the women is relieved of cooking in the evening, women is relieved of catering to parents-in-law and children, and she participates in the decision making. That really revolutionized the whole process of implementation. 90% to 100% attendance was there in Gram Sabha. And wherever any false claims were made, women will shout that this is false, this is wrong, not, don't do it. Because generally males are trained to serve the powerful. Because otherwise, if you don't serve the powerful, you will get the backlash. Women have been protected from that. So they never realize that if they come in the way of a powerful person, they will face some problem. They struggled. And decision making in Madhya Pradesh was so good that after this implementation in 2008-09, till now, there has not been any single Naxal event. Whereas next door in Chhattisgarh, in 2013, one of the national party's leadership, 25 of them were wiped out in one mine blast in Jiram Ghati. That kind of thing happened. And even in Madhya Pradesh, before the implementation of this act, one of the ministers was killed by the Naxal. Because whenever tribals are unhappy, whenever tribals are dissatisfied, disgruntled from the administration, they will support Naxal in their midst. But when they found that their problems are being not only seen but heard and resolved, they felt that now Naxals are persona non grata and they should run away from here. And that is what really helped the tribal areas of Madhya Pradesh like anything. Fortunately for me also, for my team, I myself and four other officers of my team got Prime Minister's Award for this on 21st April 2010 at Vigyan Bhavan. So it was duly rewarded for all of us.
Very nice. So any moment in your career where you thought that, okay, now I should quit as an officer?
Yeah, this happened when I returned from Delhi. I was being shunted every month from one posting to other posting because I was a little misfit. A lot of water had flown in the local administration and politicians had their way to extract whatever they wanted, whereas I came fresh from Delhi and I put my foot down that nothing doing, everything has to be done honestly and in a straightforward manner. So minister won't tolerate me for more than a month. So when 3-4 transfers took place, I thought I must leave it for good and join some other thing. But fortunately, good sense prevailed on the chief minister and he persuaded me not to leave. And then he said, I'll give you some place where you can stay for at least 2 years. And that is what happened.
Any mentor in your life, sir?
Yes, I have 2-3 mentors in my life. Basically, they are of the same feathers like me in the civil service. Very honest, straightforward, never compromising, and had very good career also. They are in Madhya Pradesh and one of them was in Delhi also. So I had very good advice from them, and whenever I felt that I am against a challenge which is insurmountable for me, I would always look up to them and they would always help me out.
So how was your journey as Election Commissioner of India?
Oh, that is a very challenging job actually in our conditions. I joined the Election Commission of India as Election Commissioner on 14th August 2015. And the team was very good. Dr. Naseem Zaidi was Chief Election Commissioner. Myself and Mr. Achal Jyoti from Gujarat, we were commissioners. And during that period from 15th to 17th, a lot of challenging things came up to the Election Commission. Like in one election, we found that 90 crores had been distributed in one assembly constituency, cash. That was huge. And therefore, we felt that with so much of cash having been distributed in the assembly area, I think our environment is vitiated and therefore we should do something about it. But the law did not have any provision. The law had a provision that if there is booth capturing or violence like this, then Election Commission can cancel that poll and reschedule a re-poll. And if it is large-scale booth capturing, then can cancel the poll in the whole constituency and can reschedule. But it was not booth capturing, and with EVM coming in, booth capturing is in fact gone, because EVM take for one vote at least 20 seconds, whereas the ballot, you can just thuck and put all ballots in just matter of half an hour. So booth capturing is in fact finished with the advent of EVM. But this money is an issue even now. When commission decided that we must cancel this poll because we have caught the evidence that 90 crores have been distributed, so we must cancel the poll. So we passed a speaking order invoking plenary powers under Article 324 under the ruling of Honorable Supreme Court, where Honorable Supreme Court in 1977 had ruled that whenever Chief Election Commissioner comes up against a challenge, he is not supposed to fold his hands and pray to God, that God give me power to meet this challenge. He, whatever solution he devises to deliver the poll in free and fair manner, that becomes the law. So using those plenary powers, Election Commission cancel that poll. The aggrieved person who had distributed 90 crores went to the High Court, then the Supreme Court, but all the courts upheld the order of Election Commission. So that kind of challenges many a times occurred.
So as a public, we see that thousands of crores are expended in during the time of election. And as a layman, what my personal thinking is, election is equal to investment. So what does the election commissioner or that election department do while they spend thousands of crores in election?
Actually, there is a lacuna in our this election law. There is a ceiling on expenditure by each and every candidate. If it is legislative assembly, then it is 28 lakhs. And if it is parliament, Lok Sabha, the expenditure ceiling is 70 lakhs. But there is no ceiling on party expenditure, political party expenditure. So what happens that most of the expenditure is done through the party town, and that makes everyone feel that crores and crores are being spent in every constituency and election commission is not able to do anything, whereas the limit is 28 lakhs in assembly and 70 lakhs in parliament. They don't discriminate between the candidate's expenditure and party's expenditure. That is the problem. So election commission had recommended to the government that they should amend the law and they should put a ceiling on political party expenditure also. But that has not materialized as yet. I hope that in some day this will materialize, and then there will be some semblance of normal behavior as far as campaign finance and election expenditure goes.
So what are your achievements as an officer?
The most important achievement is that I feel satisfied at the end of the day. That whatever came my way, I gave my best to that and delivered in even challenging circumstances. Nowhere I compromise even slightest level, nothing. Every time it was done as per the rule book, whosoever is in front may suffer or may win, doesn't matter. But I would close my eyes from personal identities, just see the law, see the rules, see the facts and deliver according to the law, rules and facts. And that really stood me in good stead. I never repented. There were repercussions sometimes, like when I was in defense, in one of the procurement deals, I found that there was preliminary evidence of some hanky-panky going on. So I recommended that it should be cancelled. Whole process should be cancelled because something wrong is happening. Though vested interest was so much agitated because of that, because you know their stakes are very high. They spend a lot of money and they have to recover that money from whatever commission they get. So when I submitted this file and I was returning, my car met with an accident on Lodi Road. I was driving myself and a truck came from behind and rammed into my car. They must have felt that this fellow must have died, would never come back. But for their misfortune, I got cured and I came back in 15 days. And then it was realized that accident was stage managed by at the behest of those people who got hurt because of the cancellation of that deal. So those kind of things happen. But if you have been working in a straightforward manner, if you have been fair to your team members, if you have been social with your colleagues and with other stakeholders, then everybody works for your welfare, for your well-being, and you never suffer anything which may be untoward.
So many times, as far as public is concerned, the image of politicians, bureaucrats, general government officers are of that they all are corrupt, and the public is not comfortable in meeting government officials. They don't have access to meet you guys. So how come this impression can be removed, and if friendly behavior can be made between government officials and public?
Actually, it has got something to do with the human idiosyncrasy. Every individual has different idiosyncrasy. And even if you put in place all kinds of rules, regulations, directions to provide access to common man, it may not materialize. So what best can be done is open up all the government services to be delivered without any human interface. Because technology advancement is so much that just deliver everything without any human interface. And I think public will be very happy. Like, you know, railway reservation. Earlier it was so difficult, and now sitting at home you can have your railway reservation, certificate, Aadhaar, PAN card, anything you can have. Whenever you have something which is beyond the rule, that is the time when you have to approach someone. Now that is something which is extraordinary, and that requires extraordinary dispensation. There you should have no grudge in waiting to meet the officer or whatever comes your way while resolving that. I think you should have no problem on that.
It has been seen ki bahut sare bacche aise hain jo ki apna decision nahi le pa rahe hain ki mere ko IAS banna chahiye ya nahi banna chahiye, ya ye decision nahi le pate hain ki mere ko job chhod ke IAS ki taiyari karni chahiye ya job ke sath IAS ki taiyari karni chahiye. So what would be your advice? So leaving job and then practicing for IAS examination would be better, or be in your job and then practice for it?
Actually, first of all, they must think that civil services offer only about 1,000 openings every year, not more. So when lakhs and lakhs of people appear, it is a kind of lottery. Just 1,000 people or around will get it. So never think that this is the only career. There is a plethora of career opportunities all around you. So first thing you must judge, whatever is your own intrinsic liking from within yourself, what work will please you, will not look like work, will look like play. That is where you must go. Second thing you must see, if you really want to earn a lot of money, then never go for public service. Although public service offers you good money now after the various pay commissions, it offers you good salary, good perk, good post-retirement benefits, but still it is nothing as compared to private sector. So if your interest is making lot of money, having Ferrari and all kinds of glamorous things, then you should go for private sector job. You are made for civil service, just that, because it will require lot of perseverance, lot of hard work, lot of problems on political interface, and at times lot of frustration also. So with all that, will you be happy? Will you really like that kind of job for yourself? And last is your own level of working, whether you can work that hard to compete to that out of few lakhs 1,000 will be selected. With all those considerations, you make up your mind and do it, and I think you will succeed in your career.
So is there any checklist, sir, of do's and don'ts which a student can follow while preparing for IAS examination?
Yes, certainly. The most important thing is study alone doesn't take you anywhere. So don't just focus for 16 hours of study. No, you must have time to look after your body, to look after your body's biological clock, to look after your body's nutrition needs, to look after your physical and social needs like sports, like talking to people, networking, all those things. These are essential to shape your personality as a person who is fit for civil service or public service. With that, you should read very limited. Never try to read so much that I must know everything, because memory, number one, memory is limited. Number two, random access memory, which is critical for competition. In terms of computer language, random access memory means you have to retrieve where that memory is stored for a particular question. Now that ability is also limited, and therefore if you have lot of jungles and jungles of memorizing things in your mind, at the time of need you will not be able to retrieve it. It will be worthless, it will be useless for you. So best thing is to study limited, keep trying to retrieve it. That means you must test yourself every now and then, practicing with exam papers, practicing with test papers from different coaching centers, so that you understand that whatever you have learned, you can easily retrieve at the time of need. Do all those things. If you are doing all those things, only then you will be able to write an exam with sizable scores. That is very important.
So what advice would you like to give to young officers, and how should they cope up with their day-to-day challenges?
Whatever you did before writing your competition exam, I think that you should carry. Our systems, age-old systems of yoga, pranayama, meditation, these are golden systems. And when you go for training, either at Mussoorie or at any other training institutions like Sardar Vallabhbhai Patel Police Academy or Nagpur Income Tax Academy, wherever you go for training, they afford you an opportunity to revise your physical training, yoga, pranayam, meditation, all those things. Take these seriously, because these are not worthless, these are not useless. As I said, for competition, study alone is not sufficient. Even for training and even for performing in the field, these are more important than any other thing. If you practice these things regularly, you will be fully prepared to meet any challenge. You will not get angry on any issue, on any problem. You will always be calm, quiet, composed, which is required of an administrator. And you will be able to focus on whatever is needed at challenging times. So all these things are going to help you a great deal. Not only this, not only in your job, these things will help you in making work-life balance, catering to your family needs, catering to your children's needs, and make you a comprehensive person, not just a good civil servant. Because becoming a good civil servant is one thing, becoming a good human being with, you know, 360 degrees goodness all around, that is another. So try to become a good human being 360 degrees all around yourself. That is going to hold you in high esteem of everyone.
In the time of pandemic, what advice would you like to give to young generation? Because it has been seen that a lot of people are going into depression. So how can they cope up with depression?
Yes, you are right, because at different stages of life, if this kind of thing happens, you react very differently. Like for me, I am a retired person, so for me it didn't make that kind of challenge. But a person who has to appear for his job exam or job interview and there is a lockdown will be quite depressing. But I think if that person has been taking good care of his mind and body in the way I have been telling you again and again, these kind of trivial things will not cause much damage. You will only feel that things which could have come to you this year or in next few months got postponed by a year or a year and a half. Only that much. So that much impact you will feel, and it will not cause any depression. But many children are not doing that. I have seen many children not focusing on their body or mind or, you know, their daily biological clocks, all those things. They just go after study. There it will cause depression, because studies, 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 or memorizing, memorizing, memorizing means that if there is a 1 year gap, you will feel that you will lose all your memory. You will have to read again, study again. So that kind of thing happening to children causes this kind of depression. And my advice for them will be, never lose hope, never feel depressed. These are normal things. Though pandemic once in a century, but still, since it has come, you have to protect yourself, your family members. You have to exercise all caution. You have to wear a mask. You have to keep social distancing. You have to ensure that you eat well and in a manner that you develop resistance to this kind of infection. All those things you must try. Remain a good human being by helping others also in your neighborhood, in your team, and focus on your larger goal. I have to continue preparing for the civil service exam, and someday it will be held and I'll be coming out with flying colors.
So how would you define yourself in one line?
Simple and straight, takes you place. I never tried for anything. When I got a call that I am being appointed election commissioner, I got a shock of my life that how come this happened. I never met anyone, I never talked to anyone, I never approached anyone. And after retirement, I had come to my hometown Bhopal, settled down in my home, and was reading, writing, and doing some tidbits of interviews of civil service here and there, some lectures in the academies. That was my routine. But suddenly I got this call and I realized that system is still working to ensure that simple and straight people also get a chance to prove themselves in challenging assignments.
Thank you very much, sir, for your time. It's a pleasure talking to you, sir.
Thank you, and all the very best. Thank you. To you as well as everyone.